Hello and welcome, everyone. I am SAG-AFTRA Executive Vice President Ben Whitehair. Thank you all for joining us for another SAG-AFTRA program on YouTube. To stay current with all of our events, we invite you to subscribe to this channel, which you can even do right now. We are joined by American Sign Language interpreter Bill Pugin and Erica Martinez. Today, we're going to talk about an issue that affects every one of us, our right to vote. Over the last few decades, we've seen enormous strides in removing barriers that have restricted low-income communities and people of color from casting their votes and having their voices heard. But recently, a disturbing trend has emerged, reversing some of those hard-fought victories for voter rights as politicians across America roll back laws meant to protect the voices of the most vulnerable members of our communities. SAG-AFTRA has joined forces with the NFL Players Association to protect the constitutional right of all Americans to participate in the democratic process, ensuring that they are represented by a government that reflects who they are and listens to their voices. In addition to the NFLPA, we've enlisted some heavy hitters, Rock the Vote and the Brennan Center, two nonprofit organizations that have championed voter rights and have been fighting voter suppression for decades. We've gathered a fantastic group of people for this panel discussion to encourage anyone watching this program to not only get involved in the political process, but also encourage their family and friends to do so as well. The upcoming midterms are a pivotal moment in this country's history as we see fundamental rights like a woman's right to choose being erased across America. It is now more important than ever that everyone exercises their right to vote. So without further delay, please let me introduce everyone. First, it is my great pleasure to welcome my friend and SAG-AFTRA President Fran Drescher. Fran was elected to this position in September 2021 and has spent the last year plus advocating for SAG-AFTRA members at the bargaining table in state and federal legislatures and industry forums. She rose to international stardom for her portrayal of The Nanny, which she also co-created and executive produced. The multi-award-winning and nominated actress and comedian founded the nonprofit Cancer Schmancer and, as an advocate, has been responsible for unanimous passage of a bill in Congress, has made multiple trips to Capitol Hill to lobby for health issues, and was appointed public diplomacy envoy for the US State Department during the administrations of Presidents Bush 43 through Obama 44. Currently, she is writing the book for the theatrical musical, The Nanny, and has returned to voice her role in the hit movie Hotel Transylvania 4 on Prime Video. She recently completed filming a movie for Lifetime that will be part of their summer film series. Fran, thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
Okay, next we have with us National Football League Players Association Executive Director DeMaurice D. Fitzgerald Smith. In his 10 plus years in this role, Smith has achieved tremendous progress on behalf of player safety and athlete compensation. Among his notable achievements was signing a 10-year collective bargaining agreement in 2011 with NFL management, leading the players through the owner's 132-day lockout. Before working with the NFLPA, Smith worked alongside former United States Attorney General Eric H. Holder and served as a partner in firms Latham & Watkins, LLP, and Patton Boggs, LLP in Washington, D.C. He serves on the board of directors for ULLICO, the board of directors for the U.S. Congressional Award, and the board of advisors for the Office for Access and Advancement for Public Black Universities. Happy to have you here with us today, Dee.
My pleasure to be here and just thrilled to be with all of you. Thank you.
Next up is Rock the Vote President and Executive Director, Carolyn DeWitt. Rock the Vote is the largest national organization focused on building long-term political power for young people. During her tenure, Carolyn has overseen Rock the Vote's resurgence, intensifying its fight for voting rights and moving the organization toward an issue-first approach with targeted outreach to marginalized communities across the country. Carolyn is a national advocate for young people, featured in publications such as the Washington Post, the New York Times, Teen Vogue, and Billboard. Carolyn, welcome. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me. Good to be back.
All right. Last, but certainly not least, please welcome Sean Morales-Doyle, Director of the Voting Rights Program at the Brennan Center. Focusing on voting rights and elections, Sean advocates for pro-voter reforms like automatic voter registration and voting rights restoration while fighting back against voter suppression efforts in the courts. Morales-Doyle is a seasoned litigator with experience in civil rights and constitutional matters, as well as a background in labor and employment law. John, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks so much for having me. I'm happy to be here.
Okay, panel of rock stars, let's dive in. Fran, people may not know this, but you are very politically active, lobbying successfully for SAG-AFTRA members, also around issues of women's health. Does your advocacy work inform how you approach elections?
Well, you know, as we say at Athletes, Actors and Athletes for Democracy, our vote is our voice. And so who I vote for is informed by what their platforms are, what they fight for, what their voter record is. Sometimes what their what their rhetoric is publicly is not necessarily how they vote in Congress. And that's something that we should all get attuned to really see for real what people, elected officials, are taking a stand on. I feel like although I represent a massive body of members of all different political associations, there are some common denominators that cannot be denied. And I feel as a leader of a labor movement that it's important that we define ourselves as taking a stand on things that are on behalf of the greater good that impact each of us and society at large.
I love that. I love that. Dee, your organization's members have a tremendous amount of influence in society. Can you tell me how do you engage with them to drive voter turnout?
Yeah, thank you. And the way we do that is really teaching history. I mean, our guys have a wonderful platform. They always like to use their voice, but you know, when you think about the history of people of color, you think about the history of groups that have been deliberately marginalized by power structures over time. How did we achieve change? We achieved change through collective action, and sometimes it meant women marching through our streets, and some of the early leaders of our labor movement were women. For people of color and others, it meant fighting the dogs and the water hoses in towns in the South. All to do what? How do we come together and be a part of the American dream, be a part of the promise of America, and realizing that the only way we can accomplish those things is working together as a collective? So we teach our players history, because sometimes it's important for them to know that they are inextricably tied to thousands, literally millions of people who have paid a much larger price than them.
Mm. Yeah. Carolyn, I saw a stat that there are more than 8 million young people that are newly eligible to vote in the 2022 midterms. How do we get them to the polls?
Yeah, good question. So not only do we have the 8 million who have turned 18 since the 2020 election, but we also have those who voted in the 2020 election, making sure that they show up. So a big part of what we do in the midterms is we see a huge drop off that's not unique to young people, but it's even more pronounced among young voters, voters from marginalized backgrounds, voters from low income backgrounds. And a big part of that is making sure that they understand the importance of the midterms and that they even exist. I mean, we take for granted, those of us who live and breathe this, right, or who do it as a, I want to say, like a big part of our lives, take for granted that the average voter understands that there are even midterms going on and what date they're happening. And for young people, they're new voters. They're going through this for the first or second time. It's in many states designed to keep them from participating in the process. We do nothing in our country to prepare 18-year-olds to take civic action as soon as they become eligible. And in what we have seen since the 2020 election, so 2018, 2020, we saw record turnout among young people. And as a result, in many states, we've actually seen a backlash of legislation trying to make it harder for them to vote. So in addition to fighting that, a lot of it is what DeMaurice said is, this is about education. It's about making sure that there is just basic civic education about the importance of the midterms, what the process is to vote, and how important this is to our democracy, particularly in this moment.
Yeah, Sean, speaking of some of those things that have been put in place that are making it harder, can you tell us a little bit more about your work and some of the reforms that the Brennan Center is recommending?
Sure. I think the Brennan Center has for a long time advocated for pro-voter reforms in states across the country, things like automatic voter registration, things like restoring voting rights to people with convictions in their past, trying to expand our democracy, welcome as many people to the table as we can, so that we can be sure that, you know, our democracy actually reflects the electorate, reflects the people of our nation. Unfortunately, right now, and I should say we've had a lot of progress on accomplishing that those reforms in many places around the country. And in the last couple of years, we've seen actually more laws expanding access to the vote pass across the country than we've really seen in a long time. At the same time, we see this divergent trend that Carolyn already referenced, where we're also seeing more laws restricting access to voting passing than we've ever seen, at least in recent memory. You know, the Brennan Center has tracked every piece of voting rights legislation introduced in every state legislature across the country for more than a decade now. And in 2021 and 2022, we've just seen more legislative activity than ever during that time period. And that includes 20 states that are going to have new restrictions to voting in place for this November's midterm elections that weren't in place during the 2020 elections. So voters have a lot of new rules to take into account, a lot of new hurdles to clear. And that's something that we're worried about. And that's why it's all the more important that organizations like SAG-AFTRA and like the Players Union and like Rock the Vote do what's necessary to encourage people to get out and give them the information they need to clear those new hurdles.
Yeah, it sounds like hearing trends between both the structural and systemic challenges, but also overcoming that through using voices and platforms. Fran, when the Queen of Queens talks, people listen. How have you been able to use your voice to encourage people to get out and vote?
You know, I think that it's trying to be nonpartisan, and I feel that that's the way to move mountains politically as well on the national landscape and in Washington. I mean, I got a bill passed by unanimous consent, which means all 100 senators said yes. There are common denominators with people that I have almost nothing in common with. And I often find that and cultivate that to generate a conversation. I think that, you know, democracy can be inconvenient sometimes because it's the voice of the majority that rules. And the majority is determined by how engaged voters are or apathetic. And so for me, I think that in its purest sense, the most important thing that I can do as an American and a leader of a labor movement is to encourage everybody to get out and vote. And then we have at least a level playing field. Everybody is engaged. And, you know, Carolyn had mentioned civics. And I really think, I mean, I always say, if I were president, I would absolutely put civic education back into core education, because it's true that people don't understand the way government works. And I believe that is by design, so that, you know, more people can have the wool pulled over their eyes, rather than being savvy, understand the way the inner workings of our government is, and to take an active participation in it. So, you know, I applaud the organizations that are present today, because really that we need the biggest megaphone around to try and quickly educate people on the absolute necessity that every single American step forward and make their voices heard through their vote.
Yeah, we're talking about having an informed electorate as much as possible as it relates to democracy as a whole. Dee, I'm curious, what do you see as the role of unions specifically in preserving our democracy?
I mean, look, there is nothing more tangible, meaningful, intimate about the labor movement than the way in which we convince our membership that together they can dictate their own destiny. And so when I look at trade unionism, when I look at our union, when I look at your union, Teamsters, teachers unions, nurses unions, all of them have as their core philosophy this understanding that we need everybody to be educated, personal interest, or not only about the things that they care about. They have to be educated and buy into, we can only accomplish these things if we do it together. I mean, there's a lot about Thomas Jefferson that I don't like, but when our forefathers say that an educated populace is a requisite for us maintaining a free world, that's something they got right. And to Fran's point, and for anybody who's probably, let's just say, a little older than many, we remember when civics were a core part of our high school and college education. Why? Those things weren't an accident. Civics, education and how government operates, we were all taught those things, not in order to make us, you know, fall in love with one party or another. They were taught to us because everyone believed and understood that that was a core philosophy that we needed to learn at a young age. And by the way, the fact that it's not a core curriculum anymore is a deliberate choice by a group of people who don't want an educated populace. So for those people who love to cite to everything that our forefathers did, again, there's a lot that I disagree with. But if you're going to buy into all of the things that they did say, we should buy into the things that remind us that they stood for an educated populace, a free government, you know, by the people, for the people. And over the years, we've gotten away from that. And that's been a deliberate action by a few who want to really subjugate the many.
Yeah, dumb them down.
Yeah, I hear in that. Go ahead, Fran.
Well, just, you know, while we're on the subject of Jefferson, you know, I just want to say that, I mean, people are going to look back at us and think, what were they thinking as they were polluting and destroying the planet unconsciously, not even seeing how the long-term impact is. So, you know, I think that every society and every generation has their own levels of ignorance and their own levels of aptitude. And the, you know, he said that America was the great experiment because these founders kind of came up with a concept that had never existed before. The idea of a government by the people and for the people, they were so close to the old way that they wanted to make George Washington the king. And he said, no, that defeats the whole purpose. There are no kings in a democracy. So, you know, they tried to think forward. But I went to the Jefferson Memorial in D.C. and there is a quote in there from him that does recognize that countries evolve, they grow, they change, they learn with the times. And he said that to try and keep a nation the same and not allow it to evolve with new thinking is the equivalent of making a grown man continue to wear the short pants that he wore as a boy. So at least they knew that change was on the horizon. And here we are. You know, we see now things that, you know, were not correct thinking, not politically correct, not fair. You know, I mean, now we're calling it Indigenous Peoples Day instead of Columbus Day. So we do keep growing. We do keep honoring more people. We do keep recognizing what this experiment is all about. And it's about freedom and equality, diversity and inclusion. And every day we need to keep very mindfully taking another step towards that vision.
John, I'm curious your thoughts, you know, as we're talking about continuing to evolve. The Brennan Center recently published some troubling research about some of the new barriers to the ballot box in 20 different states. I'm curious for people to hear some of those specifics. What barriers are they, and where did you find, you know, where are those showing up?
Yeah, I think that the barriers vary from state to state, but there are some trends that we can follow. And, you know, some of those trends are that we're seeing barriers that respond to what happened in 2020. And what I mean by that is in 2020, we saw record turnout in our presidential election, turnout that we haven't seen in a century. That's fantastic. It's something that we should all be happy about, celebrate, and try to encourage things to continue in that direction. Instead, what we saw in many states across the country is that lawmakers responded to that high turnout with a backlash against it. They started restricting precisely the types of voting, the methods of voting that voters took advantage of in 2020 in order to make that kind of turnout possible. So for instance, in 2020, as we all know, we're at the height of the pandemic. Many more voters turned to voting by mail because they felt uncomfortable voting in, you know, crowded polling places. Many of these new restrictions that we see restrict mail voting in response to that shift. There were different people using mail voting than had used mail voting in the past. Black voters were far more likely to use mail voting than they had been in the past. And what we saw was then those methods of voting used to allow for that turnout that we hadn't seen previously were targeted by these restrictions. They were targeted by those restrictions for a reason. You know, some of it was false information spread about the 2020 election, right? Lies about fraud in mail voting, for instance, conspiracy theories about the way that our elections were rigged. We at the Brennan Center have, through our research, demonstrated that there are direct links between those conspiracy theories that were pushed in the wake of the 2020 election in litigation and in false information being spread by politicians to the restrictions that are then passed by state legislatures afterwards. So they're fixing a problem that didn't exist. But there's another thing we've noticed when you ask the question of where are these things being introduced. We did an analysis, actually, of every restrictive provision introduced in every state legislature across the country to figure out what predicts where we see these new restrictions being introduced. Is it just partisan politics? Is it that one party is taking a restrictive approach and another party is taking an expansive approach? Or is there something else going on here? And we at the Brennan Center, we're a nonpartisan organization. And as Fran said, I think that's really important to emphasize. But we did see, yes, of course, I think we'd be blind if we didn't see that there's a partisan piece to where these restrictions are being introduced. But we did also see that it's more than just partisanship. What we saw were that restrictive voting provisions were most likely to be introduced by legislators who represent the whitest districts of the most diverse states in the country. They were most likely to be introduced by legislators who represent districts with high racial resentment scores. That's after controlling for party, that's after controlling for how competitive elections are in these districts. We see a story that is about race. That's long been the story in this country when it comes to the fight over voting rights and over control of our democracy, but we are seeing a shift in the way that our country looks right now. And we are unfortunately seeing a backlash to demographic shifts and to this high turnout that we saw in 2020. And if we want to accomplish the kind of inclusive, racially diverse democracy that Fran's talking about, it's important that we recognize that reality, that that is part of what's motivating these restrictions on our vote, and all the more reason for people to feel like they need to go out and exercise that right to vote. They're trying to take it away from you because they realize how powerful it is, and they realize that there is a shift in power in this country, all the more reason for people to go out and make sure that they exercise their voices.
Yeah. Speaking of that, Carolyn, hearing the Brennan Center's findings and the importance of this turnout, what are your expectations for voter turnout in these elections? What are you seeing?
Hopefully, with all of your help, you can help amplify the importance of this election. I mean, that's really what it's about. And what Sean was saying is absolutely true. We've been seeing this trend, right? And it's particularly true when you look at the youth generation, because it is becoming more diverse. And as you think about it, you have this older generation who has liked being in control, and they want to prevent the cultural diversity, basically dynamics that are going to take over, right, in our country, where it is going to become, it's going to change. And they're seeing that and they're anticipating it. And for the last decade, two decades, they've been moving toward that. And we're seeing that very much in this election, with insurrectionists running for office, election deniers running in 13 of the states with secretaries of states. We have, you know, we forget the fact that folks who are going to be elected in this election are going to be the ones certifying the 2024 election. They're going to be running the election and certifying it. So if what happened in 2020 scared us, then we all need to be showing up. But that's not the top of minds for people. And so we need trusted messengers like, you know, like talent, like athletes, anyone, brands who have a platform to be sharing this information out. And it is nonpartisan. This is really coming down to, do you want to live in a democracy or not? Because we're not out of that. Democracy is a living, breathing thing, just as Fran was saying, right? Just as this is evolving. And right now we have people who want to destroy our democracy running for the top levels of government right now. And it's, you know, they're playing the long game, and we need to be fighting back just as hard. And so for us, it's about really instilling that education of both, what's the process for young people? A lot of young people don't realize this is the same election as 2018, when young people turned out for the March for Our Lives, right? We saw that surgence. And we need to emphasize what this election is all about, and the power of states that we're seeing, the power of courts, that we need to be. I mean, we have, I don't think people really understand, we have 400 intermediate appellate judges up for election. That's nearly 100 of those almost are state Supreme Court justices. We have 84% of state legislators running for office right now. That's a huge amount of power in the states that we need to figure out how we're going to, right? If you care about access to abortion, if you care about criminal justice reform, if you care about basically any issue, right? We need to be voting in these elections, but we always think about the presidential election. So it's really about making sure we're getting out the importance of the election right now.
Yeah, yeah, I hear that, and connecting the things that the actual issues that people care about to, hey, it's not, sometimes the president may have less impact on the issues you care about than some of these other down ballot races. Sean, I'm curious, as citizens, what can we do to ensure voting rights and security for everyone? You've talked about some of the challenges. Certainly you've mentioned voting, educating ourselves on the barriers, turning out as probably the main thing. Are there other ways that we can think about how we can ensure that we can continue to have voting rights?
Yeah, so number one on the list is always go vote. I think that I would be remiss if I did not start with that. Number two on the list, when I'm talking about this with most audiences, is another thing that maybe is cliche and that people often don't think matters, but really does matter, which is go talk to your elected representatives about what you care about. And if what you care about is democracy, that should be top of the list of things that you talk to them about. I think people often think that it doesn't matter when they reach out to their representatives in Congress or to their local election officials, who often are elected officials also. It really does. I can tell you from experience, right? I spent a lot of time talking to legislators on Capitol Hill, talking to legislators in state legislatures. And they're interested to hear what a voting rights lawyer has to say, but they're a lot more interested in how many of their constituents made phone calls to their office about the issue, how many emails they got about the issue. They really do pay attention to that. And so they need to be hearing from people. These are state legislatures that are imposing these new restrictions on voting or adding new expansions to voting, they need to hear from their constituents that they want an expansive democracy and that they don't like these new restrictions, that they don't see them as fair or right. And so I encourage people to do that. I also encourage people to go sign up to be a poll worker, to go to play a role in the way democracy works in your local community, you know, to go talk and meet with your local election officials. Elections are run at the local level, and they're often run by people who sign up to be poll workers in their spare time. And it's important that people who care about our democracy sign up to do those things. But I also do want to say, given the audience for this conversation, as DeMaurice mentioned, you know, before I was a voting rights lawyer, I was also a labor lawyer representing unions. I think that unions have always played a really important role in spreading the word about democracy, because unions are themselves democratic institutions. They bring democracy to the workplace. People who are in unions understand what it means, as DeMaurice said, to have collective action on an issue. They understand that their voice matters, not just as their voice, but as part of the bigger community and the bigger voice that comes with collective action. They see how elections matter in a very real way in their own workplace. And it is important that they take that understanding and that knowledge of democratic principles out to everybody else in the world who doesn't necessarily see it in the day-to-day and understand how democracy functions. I actually think that members of unions are often more educated on all these civic principles that we've been talking about than other citizens are, because they see it play out in their everyday lives in a way that everybody else doesn't. And they also have really powerful voices. And of course, these are two unions that have tremendously powerful voices because of the reach that they have with, you know, their following. And so I think that, you know, it's important that they all go vote. It's also important that they let everybody else know that voting is a priority for them and should be for everybody else. I think that that matters. I think people forget about midterm elections. They forget about elections for secretaries of state and other election officials. And they need that reminder. They need to be reminded how important every election is and how important it is to have their voices heard. And I think these unions have the power to do that, like few others do.
Yeah, very briefly, I just want to yes to all of that, Sean. And I actually interned for Congress in DC. I interned for a congressional rep. And I can tell you, I was one of the people literally looking at those emails and logging those phone calls. And I saw firsthand, it made a huge difference when there were a high volume of phone calls, when there was a high volume of emails. It absolutely made a difference in the work that the office was doing in terms of the voting. It's not just, yeah, they actually do care. Like, I was literally in that office and I can tell you it makes a huge difference. Fran, you talked about this a little bit earlier, SAG-AFTRA being nonpartisan. How does that inform your leadership as president on issues like voting rights?
Well, voting rights is nonpartisan, basically. I mean, it's leveling the playing field so everybody has an equal opportunity to vote. I mean, it's so obvious to me that when you try and make it difficult for people to vote, you're doing that on purpose. We should be celebrating the freedom that we have to have a voice in this democracy. So, and making it easy for people to vote. I never even understood why there were particular hours. Why isn't it a 24-hour thing? So when people go to work all day and then they come home and they have to feed their kids or whatever, I mean, the polls shouldn't close. They should be open for 24 hours. If you want to go at 3 a.m., that's when it's convenient for you to go, you go. So anybody that doesn't make it easy for everyone to vote has an ulterior motive that is not in the best interest of democracy at large. And so I feel like, you know, we're a labor union, we're 160,000 people strong, and we should fight to defend this great nation of ours that's definitely a work in progress. And at a tipping point that I find extremely fearful, because people are putting their own agenda above democracy. And that's a very dangerous place for this nation to be. And I don't understand why anybody would sacrifice what we have. But I do realize that there are a lot of people, most people alive today, that actually don't know what it feels like to not have a vote. And women are a perfect example. I mean, I think that women that are supporting the overturn of Dobbs, Roe v. Wade in the Supreme Court, never lived in a time when women had profound oppression, no ability to vote, no ability to own their own land, a country where domestic violence was legal. So we don't really understand how dark things can get because we live in the luxury of a time when we're afforded more freedoms than even, you know, 100, 110 years ago. So I very much feel like as a labor leader, there's nothing more important that we can do as a union than protect and defend everybody's right to vote.
Yeah, couple quick questions and then I wanna hear final thoughts from everybody. Carolyn, the Kaiser Family Foundation just released a study saying about half of voters say they're more motivated to vote than usual. You mentioned some of these earlier, but like, what is the quick hit list? What are the things that are at stake in this election? Why should people care?
Yeah, so, you know, most people think about like, if they're thinking about midterm elections, they're thinking about the Senate and Congress basically, right? It is a split Congress right now. So we have 34 senators. Right now it's basically 50 Republicans, 48 Democrats, 2 independent who caucus with the Democrats. So could go either way, same with the House. So if you wanna continue to see, cause there actually has been, relatively speaking, a decent amount of movement in Congress over the last couple of years, more than we had been seeing, that you make sure if you care about the power in Congress, vote that way. As we've talked about, you know, in the Supreme Court's rulings in cases like Dobbs, we're seeing in deference to state rights, meaning state legislators, governors, attorney generals are becoming more important over individual freedoms and protections, you know, individual freedoms and protecting those rights. We have the power of the courts as individual rights are under attack. So looking at those local and state courts, we have attacks on democracy. So that's the Secretary of State races that we've been talking about. And again, in 13 of those 27, we have election deniers, people who have openly said, if their candidate doesn't win in 2024, they're happy to change the election results. We have, you know, and then at the local level, you have your county and your township clerks who are administering the elections. You have insurrectionists, so people who were actually at the insurrection, people who have publicly supported it, running for office as well, everything from school board to running for Congress. And then the certification of the 2024 presidential election, and then all these issues that we actually care about, right? So even if we're not getting into courts, but we want to see movement on legislation, whether that's preventing horrible legislation on the issues you care about, or actually moving something forward, those are going to happen at the state and the local and the federal level. And this is the time to do it. So, and then we have a number of ballot measures. People forget about the power of ballot measures right now. And there are some really big ballot measures happening across the country. So, you know, I would also just say, you know, one of the things, the question you asked Fran too about voting rights being, you know, how can that be a nonpartisan issue? I start out, actually, a lot of our education sessions with NFL players or others, just to set the tone, we talk about democracy requires participation by everyone. And if it's not, it's actually an oligarchy. It's a different form of government, totally. So we should be promoting voting. The US is one of the few countries in the world that requires registration among and puts the onus on the voters. People don't know, North Dakota doesn't even have voter registration. So we know that like that's possible to do. So it is in these areas where we're seeing barriers put up that we need to really be fighting against. So I will say, yeah, I'll just leave it at that, but could not stress the importance of this election.
Yeah. Carolyn, thank you. Dee, I'm curious your final thoughts, and I, if you're able to work in any information on the John R. Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act and the status of that, very curious how our viewers can support your efforts with that, and any final thoughts overall.
Look, I had the pleasure of spending a lot of time with Congressman Lewis, and we both, when we got together, I told him we share something. I'm one generation removed from a group of sharecroppers just like him. And the John Lewis Act talks about what America should be for everyone. And that's equal access to make democracy real and meaningful for every person in America. That's why the NFL Players Association supports it so hard. That's why we have so many of our players across sports, and certainly your wonderful union, Fran, supporting it so just so hard. Why? Because as we've said over and over again on this call, with democracy, there comes a duty. And whether it you have a particular interest in X, Y, or Z, it all comes down to whether we embrace our duty to preserve our democracy. And that's what's at stake, you know, in this election. And so, you know, I'm actually optimistic about where we are, because I do think that the wonderful work of people at Rock the Vote and other places have done a tremendous job of making that duty real and meaningful for people. But as we go forth, everything hangs in the balance. If people do agree that they need to fight for their democracy, we're going to be fine. If people think that they can sit back and let other people make decisions, then we will wake up one day and find ourselves in an oligarchy. It's literally that simple. I know what side of the fence I'm going to be on, and I know what side our players are going to be on. And anytime I'm able to work with all of you, that's a great day for labor, and that's a great day for America.
Final thoughts, Carolyn, Sean, Fran.
Oh, shall I begin?
Go ahead, Fran.
I guess the final thought is that I hope that everybody that's listening to this is motivated to get out and vote. Your vote is your voice. So make sure you understand what the things are that you're voting for, what the people are that you're voting for, and then figure out the best way to make that vote, whether it's by mail or in person. Just do it, because you live here, it's a democracy, and we should never take for granted our right to vote and our right to have a voice in this nation.
Thank you, Fran. Carolyn, final thoughts?
Yeah, just jump in. You know, the folks, the audience watching this are very busy people, and you all are asked to do a lot of things for a lot of different causes. And we very much recognize that. I will say a lot of these causes and issues cannot move forward if we do not have a functioning democracy to move them forward. So ask you, this is like the base level of what we need to move those issues forward. Ask you if you are interested in using your platform to please contact us. You can direct message us on social media or reach out to talent@rockthevote.org. Would love to hear from you and work with you. Thank you.
Love it. Thank you, Carolyn. Sean, final thoughts.
I mean, I'd echo everything that everybody else said, but I will just add on that, you know, I think, as Fran said, voting rights shouldn't be a partisan issue. Unfortunately, in recent years, it has become more of a partisan issue. That's new. The John R. Lewis Voting Rights Act had 51 sponsors this year, and only one of them was from the Republican Party. But in 2006, when the Voting Rights Act was last renewed, it passed by 98-0 vote in the United States Senate. Historically, we've been a country that where voting rights hasn't been a partisan issue, where we've all agreed on the idea that we care about democracy. And that needs to continue. And everybody demonstrates that by getting out and voting. They demonstrate that by committing themselves to our democracy. And I think that it is, while that partisan dynamic is new, the fight for our the future of our democracy is not new. For the entire history of American democracy, there has been an ongoing fight over who is going to be allowed to participate. And for most of our history, we've been moving in the right direction. We've been expanding who can participate. We've welcomed first Black men to the table, and then women to the table, and then younger people to the table. And it hasn't always been entirely in the right direction. We've had setbacks, but it's generally been in the right direction. We are at a risky moment right now where there are a lot of people trying to push us in the wrong direction. And for that reason, it's more important than ever that we all engage and send the message to our elected representatives that voting rights is priority number one. Democracy is priority number one, because as Carolyn said, all the other issues that we care about, we can't make progress on them unless we actually have a functioning democracy. We need to play the same role that our predecessors have played in making sure that we're moving the ball forwards towards a more inclusive democracy and not letting us slide back the other direction.
Mm. Thank you, Fran, Dee, Carolyn, Sean. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedules to show your support for voter rights and encouraging our viewers to be more active in the political process by voting for candidates and legislation that represent every American. We really do appreciate it. Before we go, I want to remind members to go to sagaftra.org/vote2022, where you can do everything from check your voter registration status, track your ballot, download our social media toolkit, and find links to amazing organizations like Rock the Vote and the Brennan Center. And as a reminder to everyone watching, this presentation is available as a replay right here on our YouTube channel, so you can watch it anytime or share that link with anybody else who might be interested. On behalf of the whole team here at SAG-AFTRA, I would like to thank you so much for watching, and a special thanks to our regular viewers who've been tuning in each week to our PTEOE President's Task Force on Education, Outreach, and Engagement live streams. If you have ideas for topics you want to see us cover, please shoot us an email, pteoe@sagaftra.org. And before we go, if you haven't already, please subscribe to SAG-AFTRA's YouTube channel to get updates on all of the great content we are posting. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks, Ben.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you.